Hey everyone, I'm Aisha Dang. Thank you so much for joining me on my channel. Today is going to be a fun video as I walk down memory lane because it is going to be about the things that I've learned while working in my 20s. You know, I was reflecting on my life last week, kind of just going back to moments that I will always remember and that kind of have shaped me to be the person who I am today. And I was thinking about a moment in particular, something that I learned during my first internship. And I'm going to talk about that, but that was kind of the linchpin of me thinking about other lessons that I have learned throughout my working career. I thought that this would be a really interesting video. It was really fun for me to kind of look back at everything and go through old videos and old photos of everything that I have done. But yeah, I hope you enjoy this video. Please like, share, and subscribe, and let's just get started. I know this is a video about my work experiences in my 20s, but we're gonna kind of rewind the clock a couple years before that to my very first job ever. The summer before my senior year in high school. And yes, 2005 is when I graduated high school, and we don't need to talk about it in the comment section because I already know how old that makes me sound, okay? But my very first job ever was actually at a law firm called Case Bigelow and Lombardi. You might be thinking, Aisha, how did you manage to get a job at a law firm for your very first job? And frankly, if we're being honest, it's because of nepotism. My godfather was a partner at the firm, and I honestly don't know what inspired me to want to get a job, probably because I wanted to go shopping or something, but he gave me a job to kind of just float around the office. He now has his own practice, but yeah, thanks Uncle Steve for the lessons learned at my very first job. And the lesson that I learned, which was a doozy, was the realities of a paycheck. I think I worked there maybe 3 times a week. It's in downtown Honolulu. And I remember either my dad or my popo would drop me off every morning and then pick me up. But I remember my very first paycheck. And I was so excited. I do not remember how much they paid me. I mean, it could not have been very much in 2004. I opened my paycheck. And again, I don't remember what the amount was. But I was floored. I was so upset about how much money was taken out of my paycheck for taxes, for Social Security, for all of that, that I made a scene, y'all. I should actually be really embarrassed about like thinking about it, but I just think it's actually really funny now. But I made a scene. I made a huge scene. And the reason why I made a scene wasn't the fact that I had so much money taken out of my paycheck, but because the dude who worked less than me made more than me. I remember kind of blowing up to the point where my godfather had to pull me into his office, explain to me like the realities of a paycheck, and I was so upset. I think I was crying that he ended up kind of giving me cash out of his pocket to balance out what was taken out of my paycheck. Yeah, dude, I was not too happy about that. But it's funny because now, as a 34-year-old, as someone who gives 50% of my paycheck to other people. If you remember, I put 30% aside for taxes and 20% goes to my management team. So what I earn, I only take home 50%, 50% of that. But if I had known then what my life was gonna be now, that 15% that was taken out of my paycheck back in the day would not have been that big of a deal. So I think that moment just kind of prepared me for the realities of just how the world is. And even though it breaks my heart to give away 50% of my paycheck currently, every time I do, I kind of think back at that moment and just have to laugh at myself. Okay, so that was high school. Now let's talk about college. Now, in 2005, okay, I guess we're still not in the 20s, but 2005, I had my first retail job. I loved me my Banana Republic cardigans so much that I wanted to work at Banana Republic. So for two summers, 2005 and 2006, the summer of 2005-2006, I worked at Banana Republic. And let me tell you, I don't know what it is now, but Banana Republic, or like the Gap Inc. Corporation, gave 50% off all items, I think 30% off leather goods, and either 30% off or 20% off sale items. So the discount was there. I fully understand that Banana Republic just ain't what it used to be. Back in the day, it used to be like the bomb, okay? Or at least for me, I thought it was the bomb. And my first position was kind of just a sales associate. I floated around mostly on the women's floor, folding up clothes, helping in the changing room, just assisting with stuff. And then I was trained as a cashier. So for the most part of my time at Banana Republic, I was actually a cashier. And what working as a cashier has taught me was, some people are just really highly disrespectful. I cannot tell you how many times I've had people throw money in my face, like legitimately. Credit cards just tossed in my face, debit cards, cash tossed in my face. And in fact, the only time I have ever cried at work ever was 2005 at Banana Republic. This guy came in, and he paid in cash. He got a bunch of stuff, he paid in cash, and I had to give him change. But I didn't have quarters in my till, so I ended up having to give him dimes and nickels. And of course, it could not have been that much. Could I have called my manager to get more quarters? I could have, but I honestly didn't think it was that big of a deal. I gave him the change, and he took it and looked at me and said, "Do you think I want to carry all of this change around in my fucking pocket?" And I was like, huh? He threw the change in my face. He legitimately threw change in my face. And he started yelling at me, telling me that I'm stupid, telling me to call the manager, all over change. So I called the manager. Mind you, there was a line at this point because he was making a scene. I wasn't crying, you know, I was trying to hold it together. The manager came down, she apologized to him, which I get it, customer service. He did not apologize to me once. She told me to take a moment, and I went into the men's dressing room and I cried. And then she dealt with him. I don't know what she did, I don't care. She came to, you know, comfort me a little bit in the men's dressing room and told me to take 5 minutes and then get back out on the floor. Did I enjoy my time at Banana Republic? For the most part, but that is, you know, an experience of mine that just kind of gives me the heebie-jeebies and makes me really, really upset. In 2006, I was so gung-ho about work and making money that I worked at Banana Republic. I opened Banana Republic, so I went in at 8:39 and left at 5. And then I would walk over, because it was in the same shopping mall, and I worked at Macaroni Grill. And what working in a restaurant taught me was, one, I have no business being in a restaurant. And two, I really get annoyed by people incredibly easily. I think that's why I didn't mind working at the law firm, and I didn't mind working as a cashier, because at the law firm, like, everyone's in their own like world, so no one bothers you until they need something from you. So for the most part, I was kind of just in my own quiet space. And then as a cashier, you don't talk to anyone until they come up and have to buy something. And even then it's like a 5 minute exchange and they're gone. Whereas like if you're helping someone as a sales associate, you're always kind of engaging. And that's exhausting to me. Like even every time I film a video, I am just so exhausted after that I have to take the rest of the day off. Which is funny because I ended up being a television host for a couple years. Yeah, man, can't stand people. Especially hungry families. They are incredibly impatient. To be honest, I don't remember too much of it. I feel like maybe I had blocked it out of my mind because it was just so unenjoyable to me. Anytime there was an opportunity for someone to go home early, because there were maybe like two hostesses and then like a main hostess person, Anytime she would ask who would want to go home, I'd be the first one to raise my hand and she would let me go because I think she just did not, like she knew that I didn't enjoy being there. But it was just a lot of people, it was a lot of noise, people being impatient about their waiting time. Like, I get that you're hungry, but also plan ahead. You know that dinner time at a shopping mall is probably going to be really busy. So plan ahead. I don't know what to tell you. So now we're like kind of peeking into my 20s, but during college, so 2005 to 2009, during the school year, I actually was heavily involved in the wedding industry. So one of the very first people that I met, friends that I made in San Francisco, was my friend Catherine Kalabokas, because her boyfriend, now husband, was the assistant coach for a baseball team that my ex-boyfriend was a part of. So I would always see her at all the games and stuff. And she is a wedding planner. She is actually one of the premier wedding planners in San Francisco, the Bay Area. She does beautiful weddings. Her company is called Dream a Little Dream Events. I was her assistant wedding coordinator. That was my title. Anytime she needed help. But basically what that meant was I would just go in the day of the wedding and do whatever needed to be done, whatever she needed help with. So that was setting up the ceremony and reception. That was, you know, making sure the brides and the grooms are ready to, you know, walk down the aisle or on time for photographs or on time for toasts or anything. Refilling tables, like goodie tables or whatever, making sure all the other vendors are happy. So again, something that I enjoyed because no one talked to me. I was around a lot of people, but no one talked to me. And again, very task oriented. After that, actually, when I graduated undergrad, my very first job after college was, like, after college before I moved down to LA, because the wedding industry is like pretty tight knit, I got an assistant manager job at a bridal salon called Hot Bride in the Marina District in San Francisco. So we did a lot of dress fittings, a lot of custom jewelry, and I really enjoyed that. So I did that up until I actually moved to LA. So again, 4 year span of me working in the industry into my 20s. So now we finally made it to my 20s. But the one thing that I learned while working in the wedding industry, while it's a very lovely industry, I mean, you're helping people kind of plan their big day, is I don't really want a big day. If Brian and I could get married and it just be us at City Hall, I would prefer that. The whole to-do is just a lot. In fact, there's a show on Netflix now called Marriage or Mortgage, where people have a set amount that they can either contribute to a wedding or a mortgage. And most of them put that like $30,000 to a wedding, and I had to stop watching because it made me so upset. I just can't justify something like that. I totally get the symbolism. And if you want to, you know, do a big wedding, I know in Asian cultures, it's like really important to do huge weddings and invite your dad's friend from high school's daughter. But for me, if I don't talk to you every day, if I don't know you personally, you ain't invited. Period. Now, during my senior year in college, so 2009, up until that point, I was studying marketing. Like, I, for some reason, was inspired by Samantha Jones for Sex and the City and thought, you know, I can be in PR, I can be in marketing, I can do this stuff, and realized quickly that that's not something I want to do. But I realized during my classes for marketing are that the classes that I really enjoyed were classes that heavily involved public speaking. I really enjoyed presenting. I really enjoyed public speaking, which is funny because it gives me anxiety now. But in college, I was totally into it. And that kind of made me think that maybe I want to be a television host. And my very first internship ever was at Comcast Sportsnet Bay Area. And I was there for 1 semester. That was actually my very first time experiencing racism. So my time as an intern for a sports network was, what did I do? I mostly kind of just transcribed live sporting events to text. And then because I knew I wanted to be on camera, I befriended kind of like editors and producers, not to necessarily be on camera for Comcast, but just kind of learn what they knew. So some of the people that I actually talked to this day were editors and producers from my time back at Comcast. But because of that, because people knew that I was really interested in learning, I was invited to go to pre and post game press conferences. This was during baseball season. So I went to one basketball game, but it was mostly baseball, San Francisco Giants baseball pre and post game conferences. There was a press conference that I went to very close to graduation that myself, a producer that I've gone to games with multiple times, and then another girl who happened to have been Asian, we all went to the post-game press conference. And for me, I just sit quietly. Like, I know my place. I know that I shouldn't really speak. I know to sit and listen and learn. But, you know, that's what I did. But so I don't remember what was said, but the other girl that came asked the stupidest question during a post-game conference. And I don't remember what that question was, but I remember the feeling of thinking to myself, huh? And then the following Monday, I was told that I shouldn't come into work and that I was fired. And what had happened was essentially is that someone mixed the two Asian girls up and told them that I said something stupid, because apparently you can't tell Asian girls apart. And it didn't really occur to me that that was racist. I was mostly concerned about my grade for school, because again, this was something that I needed to do for credit. So immediately, the first thing I did was email my teacher about the situation. I was so upset. Never in my life have I ever been fired from anything. Even like, actually, that's a lie. By the way, we were two totally different Asians. I'm Chinese and she was Japanese. So it's just like this total ignorance, you know, ignorance, the whole thing. And also kind of not just assuming that it was me and then firing me without allowing me without hearing my side of the story was really weird. But I honestly, like I keep on saying, I didn't realize it was racist for a really long time. It's not a racism where I was punched, spit at, told to go back home, you know, called a chink. It wasn't that kind of racism. But someone confusing two Asian girls is racist. This was kind of the catalyst of this video, because with the rise in hate crimes against the AAPI community and what happened in Atlanta, it's been really interesting to come to terms with my experience with racism, because I posted this on an Instagram, but since I was born in Hawaii, I didn't experience any racism because we were all mixed raced. The majority of us were Asian, and we are very multicultural at its root. That's what Hawaii is. So, you know, moving to the mainland and experiencing that kind of microaggression was really weird. And also now with everything going on, it's hard for me to come to terms with my experiences, even though that was like 10 years ago. That still shouldn't have happened. And we shouldn't be where we are today trying to defend ourselves, you know, yelling out loud that this happens to us. And I know I'm someone who's like very vocal about situations. Like I did a whole video about Planned Parenthood and why I'm pro-choice. Did a whole, you know, I do a lot of videos about the environment. I did a video during last summer's Black Lives Matter movement. So I understand that people are looking to me to maybe post a video about this, but I'm just exhausted. So I appreciate those of you who look at me as being a leader in our community, but I just don't have the bandwidth right now to do a video about it. That experience will never, ever leave me. Another thing I did in 2009, since I had the worst experience in television earlier that year, I found something on Craigslist that piqued my interest. Another lesson I learned in 2009 was that sometimes you have to pay your dues. So as you remember, I was new to television and everything that involved it, and I just needed experience. Comcast was the only thing on my resume, but I needed on-camera experience to build my reel, and a reel is basically a commercial of your work. So I was on Craigslist one night looking at like the, I guess, gig section, and I came across a hosting gig in Berkeley for Access Television as an interviewer for like an indie band TV show. It was not paid. I took the BART, I think probably once a week for 10 weeks to Berkeley to interview indie bands in the Berkeley area. It was called Yeah Live. And like I said, you just gotta pay your dues. I mean, I met some really cool bands. Some of the bands I actually still keep in contact with, but the producer was absolutely crazy. He was completely unhinged. And there was one time that I was interviewing someone, and during it, he was yelling. I don't know what happened between him and the audio guy, but he was yelling in the studio. But as a true professional, I kept the show going. But let me tell you, it was just horrible. I learned a lot. I had great experience. The one thing I am really good at with hosting is that I do spend a lot of time researching the people that I'm interviewing. So that's something that I learned to do. I learned how to engage. I learned how to block out distractions. But let me tell you, you gotta pay your dues, and that's that. Okay, so now we're in Los Angeles, and I am coming up to my final year of grad school at USC. I have my master's in broadcast journalism, and during kind of the end of the first year, going into the second year, people were already starting to talk about what they wanted to do after graduation. They started applying to, you know, various internships or gigs. And most of the people that I went to grad school with wanted to be like in hardcore journalism. So they were applying to, you know, Al Jazeera, LA Times, New York Times, CNN, all that stuff. And for me, that never really interested me. I've always wanted to do something more on the entertainment end. It got me thinking, like, what type of show, what is my ideal show that I wanted to be a part of? And what I learned in 2011 is sometimes you have to shoot your shot, okay? So what I did was I thought about my ideal television show. And for me, that was a sports show in which I would interview athletes and they would teach me how to play their position. And for me, that was kind of the perfect balance of the kind of sports I wanted to do. It wasn't really statistic heavy. It was more lifestyle involved and getting to actually know these athletes, because it was my thought that, you know, people would open up if they're able to do something that they're comfortable with. So that was my idea of an ideal sports show. And then I had to think about what, you know, organization or network would I want to pitch this to. And for some reason, I thought Maxim Magazine. And I don't know if Maxim Magazine is still around, but back in the day, it was a huge men's magazine. And I thought that that show would align with Maxim Magazine because, you know, it's more lifestyle based. You get to meet your favorite athlete. And again, you have like a good looking girl talking to athletes. What would, you know, that's like the trifecta of a men's magazine. And then I thought to myself, how do I get seen? How do I meet the people at Maxim that I need to pitch the show to in order to get it? This is like such a to-do, but at the time, Maxim Magazine had this competition called Hometown Hotties, where your hometown hottie can apply to be in the magazine. And it was like a whole thing. The winner got a cover and everything. And I was like, okay, so this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to apply to Hometown Hotties. I'm going to be able to meet all of the people at Maxim Magazine. I'm going to pitch my show idea, and I'm going to be a Maxim Sports show host on Maxim.com. That is what I'm going to do. And guess what? Bitches, I did it. I applied to be in Hometown Hotties. I think the initial was 1,000 girls, and then it was whittled down to 500, and then 100, and then I got into the top 10. And because I was in the top 10, I was flown to Vegas. It was my very first time going to Vegas. I flew to Vegas. I met the editor-in-chief. I met the head of marketing. I met the head of digital. I didn't win. It's okay. I didn't win, but I was able to meet the people that I needed to meet, and when I knew the moment was right, I pitched my show idea. I emailed it to the editor-in-chief. I still have the email that I sent in my email because it was such a life-changing moment for me. And they gave me my show. And I know that that whole story seems so silly and maybe so, you know, Asia specific, but you just have to shoot your shot. You know, if you want something so badly, you need to figure out a way to make it happen for you. And that's exactly what I did. So that show ended up being called Max and Sports One-on-One. I interviewed Shaq, I interviewed like Danica Patrick, Floyd Mayweather, I interviewed a bunch of people, and it was my idea. It was my pitch. I was in a very tight group. It was just me, a videographer, a producer, and like the head of digital. We would be the only people going to, you know, the Final Four or the Super Bowl. And it was just so fun. It is exactly what I needed during that time. And it gave me the experience. It gave me the content for a reel. And because of that, because of Maxim Sports One-on-One, that catapulted me to other opportunities in the mainstream media with FX, The Hollywood Reporter, Clever Movies, which is no longer around. But my time at Maxim was the linchpin in the rest of my life. So that is a story that I'm very proud of. It is a lesson that has allowed me to get to where I am now. And it has, you know, I think also if you follow me, you know that if I have something in mind, I do it, you know, and that was the reason why I'm so confident in myself. So shoot your shot. You have nothing to lose. After Maxim Magazine was bought out, my crew was approached to be a part of like a competition at Fox Sports. Basically, they asked a bunch of people to kind of submit their sports show, and the winner would get a sports show on Fox Sports or something. Anyways, we kind of just repurposed Maxim Sports One-on-One because we couldn't use the word Maxim anymore, but we retitled it The Best Dang Sports Show. That was the sports show that we pitched to Fox Sports. We didn't win. I actually have never seen the content of the winner anywhere. But Fox Sports liked me so much that they asked me to be a part of an online sports show called At the Buzzer. And what I learned during my time at Fox Sports is that I need to be in charge. The creative freedom that we had at Maxim did not happen at Fox. And that's just because in network television, you have to go through all these hoops. Your videos need to be approved. You have to make sure that there's no conflict of interest in terms of what you say with the advertisers. And we didn't have that at Maxim. We could literally do and say whatever we wanted. And that was kind of the freedom I enjoyed and I grew up my, you know, hosting career with. So having that taken away from me was really, really, really jarring. It was pitched to me that being online, they wanted to be a more edgier version of the Fox Sports shows that were on television, but they really didn't want to. And maybe they did and they couldn't because of advertisers and the people higher, like above us. And it was just a really suffocating experience creatively for me. Again, also coming from Maxim, where we had like, it was the wild, wild west. They let us do whatever we want and we didn't have to answer to anyone. Fortunately, it didn't last very long. I think I was only there for a couple months. I don't think the show was still on YouTube anymore, but that's the one thing that I learned is that I needed creative freedom. And now we are coming into like 2015, 2016, which is the end of my 20s. And what I learned during that time was that it is okay to reinvent yourself. Throughout kind of my YouTube journey, I have reinvented myself multiple times. When I first started my YouTube channel, it was very heavily geared towards men because that was what my following was. It was very much talking about relationships and dating and women and all that stuff. And then I kind of like grew out of that phase and had to re-pivot somehow and started doing like makeup tutorials and fashion hauls, which is really weird because that's just not who I am at all. But that lasted a little bit. And then I pivoted to where I am now, which is really weird as this like financial guru on YouTube, which is so weird because who would have thought like that this is where I would be? But I feel like I'm the only person that I follow that has been able to successfully pivot multiple times online while also keeping some of my original viewers. And I'm fortunate enough to where the guys that followed me on their Maxim days have somehow introduced their girlfriends or their wives to me, and now they're both able to watch me. So I think that's really cool. And I think the reason why I was able to do that successfully is because at every stage that I was at, personally, professionally, I was just showing you my authentic self. When I was uploading content geared towards men, I was still authentically myself, because at the time I was dating. So I was single. So as I was telling stories or like advice, that was advice I was giving to these guys because I would want to see it. When I was doing makeup or fashion, that was still authentically myself. I was still trying to figure it out. I was only uploading like natural makeup or natural makeup tutorials or top 10 makeup tips for a beginner, stuff like that. And then when I pivoted to, you know, vlogging, that's actually, you know, that's obviously myself, that's my life. And then when I pivoted to finances, obviously that was authentically me because I showed you kind of the worst of it. And I think that's what allowed me to make so many transitions successfully, is because, you know, I guess I really don't care what you all think of me, so I'm not ashamed to show you every aspect of me and my life. And you know, I think that is kind of really cool, and I think that's something that I love about myself, is that I am only ever authentic to my feelings and who I am and what I believe. So those are the things that I have learned throughout my various working journeys from 17 to 34. I know this video was very long, but I hope at least you found it entertaining and hopefully found it informative. And yeah, like, share, and subscribe. Leave a comment with one of the things you've learned on your working journey. Doesn't have to be now. It could be something that happened back in the day. But yeah, I'm Asia Dang. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you all next video. Bye.